Yes, well, back when I was doing my undergraduate degree between 1978 and 81, this was, of course, prior to any laptops or desktop computers for presenting stimuli. So we had to use tachistoscopes, these big machines that you look into to be presented with visual stimuli of various kinds. And in order to actually time when they presented the stimuli, you had to hook them up literally by wires, which you would screw into each Birkbeck timer, as they were called. So I remember in my last year as an undergraduate at Cardiff, I ran a tachistoscope study of looking at emotional expressions, different kinds of emotional expressions. So what I did was I took photographs of a student friend of mine, framed face photographs in black and white, and she acted different facial expressions for different emotions. And the idea was, back in the day, was that a neuropsychologist that I was working with had this idea that the different halves of the brain were better at processing what he called light versus dark emotions. I can't remember which. But what we did was, essentially, when you look into the tachistoscope, you fixate on a central point, and you can literally, by putting cards in, I can't remember if it's left or in the sides or in the top, but you literally insert these cards with your photograph on to the left or the right of the fixation point. And because of the way in which the brain is wired up, if you present a card to the left of the fixation point, the information of it crosses over and goes to the right side of the brain, to the right occipital cortex. So we did this presentation of stimuli, left side, right side, random, different emotions, to try and see whether the right side or the left side recognized light and dark emotions more quickly. I think we did get a significant result, but it's more etched upon my mind because of the what was really etched upon my mind about the whole experience was actually just the setting up of the equipment. It wasn't, you know, a quick let's click on a few links in a program and present things within a pre-written nice piece of software, because they didn't exist. You had to literally build it and press buttons on the Birkbeck typers for things to be timed in various kinds of ways. So I remember working with the technician at Cardiff, who was very deliberate and well-paced, let's say, in terms of his work on these things. And we had these three Birkbeck timers and this tachistoscope in the soundproof room in the tower block of Cardiff University, set up for most of the term, actually. It was like a sort of a major end of third year project, really. The tachistoscope was, of course, absolutely at the center of this. And there were many of them in use for similar purposes, because it's a, I suppose, when I first saw it, I thought it looked a bit like something you'd find on the bridge of a ship, looking down at it like an echo sounder. But actually, it just tunnels your vision, and you look at this central point, and you then present your stimuli to the right and the left. But of course, when computers happened, that began to fade away pretty quickly. And we're only really talking a matter of 3 or 4 years, because desktop computers, IBM PCs in particular, began to proliferate, I suppose, in around 1983, 84. I first encountered large rooms of them when I was a graduate student visiting the United States. I hadn't seen these in such numbers before, but when they came in and people start, oh, we can present stimuli on them, it was into the dustbin of history went the poor tachistoscope.